Join us for a trip to Europa, one of Jupiter's moons, as we review the Artemis Project from our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild, whom we have to thank for handing over a review copy of this dice placement game at Origins 2023.
The Artemis Project was designed by Daryl Chow and Daniel Roki. Might be Rossi, I'm not sure which, I apologize, and features artwork from Josh Capel and Dominic Mayer. Was originally Kickstarted back in 2019 and is available in three different versions. The retail version, the Pioneer Edition, and the Galileo Edition.
The version we are looking at today is the Galileo Edition. It includes 30 metal expedition tokens and everything in the Pioneer Edition. That includes spot-coated box, recessed player boards, miniatures for the Embassy and Snowcat, and the Alien Relic and Directives mini expansion, as well as everything in the retail edition.
Now note that Grand Gamers Guild themselves only has copies of the Pioneer and Galileo versions left. And honestly, if you're going to pick this game up, and I'll get into why later, you want to at least go with the Pioneer edition. Like, the metal tokens in Galileo are nice, you don't need them, but you're going to want those other upgrades.
Plus, there's the added bonus that if you do buy direct from Grand Gamers Guild, you can use our code Bellhop, B-E-L-L-H-O-P, to save 10% off.
Now, getting back to the game info. The Artemis Project plays 1 to 5 players with a game time, I would say over 2 hours at the higher player count, getting quicker the less players you have.
While this game does have some meat on it with a Board Game Geek weight rating of 2.83, we found it flows really well and people pick it up quickly. With a group of experienced players, the playtime can be much shorter.
So in the Artemis Project, you're a team of stabilizers helping to build a colony on the ocean moon of Jupiter, Europa. You start by harvesting materials and energy under the thick ice crust, building resource generation buildings under this icy crust. You'll recruit new colonists as well as train and upgrade the ones you have, embark on dangerous expeditions on the moon's surface, and deal with unpredictable events. Halfway through the game, though, your focus is going to shift from resource generation to endgame scoring as you start to build buildings on the surface. Now, all of this is handled through a unique dice placement and displacement system where what your opponents roll is as important as what you rolled, where player order can really matter, and where low rolls can be just as useful as high ones.
For a look at the components in the Galileo edition of the Artemis Project, check out our unboxing video on YouTube.
Now remember, the only thing that's unique to Galileo are the metal tokens I open up. They're kind of near the end. Everything else I show off, you're going to get in the Pioneer edition. And everything's really top-notch quality. The dual-layer player boards work well. The iconography in this game is fantastic. The fact that the two main resources are not only different shape, but made up of different materials. You've got translucent plastic cubes versus wood cylinders, and that's fantastic for accessibility. Each of the different colonist types have unique colors and shapes, like lots of great premium updates that are in this game.
Now, while some of the components are a bit over the top, like the big chunky embassy miniature and the somewhat silly shake ship dropship for randomizing what colonists show up, it never goes quite too far. And if you really don't like the ship, there's always a drawstring bag that comes with it. Now, personally, I'm also not a big fan of shuffling tiles and would have preferred cards for the buildings, but that's really a me thing.
Now, before we get to an overview of play, I do want to call out the instructions, the rule book in the Artemis Project for being very clear and well-organized with lots of examples. This is one of the better board game rule books I've ever read. I also want to note, though, that the box does not come with any form of organization at all, other than some extra baggies. If you enjoy this one as much as we have, you might want to look into some form of third-party box insert or making your own.
Now on to that overview of play. Note, this is going to be pretty fairly high level. Look at the gameplay just to give you an idea of the mechanics and their interactions to let you know if it sounds like the kind of thing your group would enjoy. Please do not consider this a full rules teach.
No, we're going to skip over quite a bit here. So everyone picks a color, takes the player board and the playing piece in that color, grab 3 minerals, 3 energy, 1 toolkit, and 1 pioneer, and put those on your player board. Your score and relief markers go on the main board, which is then seeded with 4 of each of the other colonist types, which are engineers, marines, and stewards. The rest of the colonists are put into the bag or the shapeship. Building tiles, expedition cards, and event deck are shuffled. 6 event cards are taken from the deck, and the rest are put back in the box.
Next, you go through board setup. This is done at the start of the game as well as at the start of each round. Expedition cards are drawn and displayed next to the board. The vents and quarry are filled with energy and minerals based on the numbers of those cards. A number of buildings are drawn and displayed on the other side of the board. New colonists are dumped out of the shake ship or drawn from the bag, and an encounter card is revealed.
Now, the encounter cards include a mix of banes and boons, good and bad things, which take effect during a specific phase of the game during the resolution section. You're going to use that chunky embassy marker, the event marker, to remind you where that's going to happen. Now, a random player is given the snow cat. That's the starting player token. They can then keep it and go first, or they can put one energy or one material on it and pass it to the next player. Yes, the nice mini is big enough to actually hold some resources. That player can take it and the resources, or put another resource on it and pass it to the next player, and so on, until someone decides to go first and gets all the resources stacked.
Next, everyone rolls their dice and then take turns placing them on the board, starting from the player with the snowcat, going clockwise. At this point, you don't resolve anything. You do that after everyone has placed all of their dice. Mm-hmm. Also, when placing dice, players can use toolboxes to roll their dice up or down, 1 pip per toolbox.
Now, there are 7 places you can place your dice. You can place at the base camp to take part in expeditions, in the vents quarry to gain resources, at the gantry to build buildings, on the doorstep to recruit new colonists, at the academy to promote an existing colonist, or at the outfitter for victory points or more toolkits.
The dice placement rules vary depending on where you place. At the base camp, dice are stacked bottom to top, and the colonists can be played along with your dice to modify yours or your opponent's dice, or give you a special bonus if the expedition succeeds.
Now, at the vents, quarry, and doorstep, lowered value dice bump higher dice to the right. At the gantry, once a die is placed, another die can only be placed there if it's higher than the dice already on the building. And in the academy, only has room for 2 dice total and has to be played with a colonist. Any number of dice of any value can be placed in the outfitter. Now, when placing at the outfitter, this is the one place where you get the reward right now, which potentially could give you toolkits that can be used later in this planning phase.
Once all dice are placed, you resolve each section in order, starting with the base camp. Each expedition card is resolved, where they either succeed or fail, depending on the total of the dice placed there. Players who contribute the most get a medal and get to pick one of the rewards on the card, and the player who contributed second most gets the other reward and a medal. Any other players there suffer from exposure and go up on the relief track.
Now, both events and quarry resolve the same. Starting from the lowest number die and working upwards, resources equal to the value of the dice are given to the appropriate players. If the resources run out, any remaining dice get nothing, but their players do get to go up on the relief track.
The gantry works as an auction. Players have the option to build the building their dice are on by paying a matching amount of mineral. The player with the highest die value gets that option first, then the next lowest die, and so on.
Now, the doorstep's pretty close to the vents and quarries, with players getting to hire new colonists at the cost of 2 energy each. The difference here is the die value determines how many colonists you can hire. If it gets to your die and there are no colonists left, you get to go up on the relief track.
Players at the academy discard the colonist they sent there and take the appropriate replacement from the board if available. If they aren't available, they get nothing, nor do they go up on the relief track.
Now, while resolving these actions, remember the event card that was revealed at the start of the turn. That's going to resolve at one of the appropriate places on the board, one of the regions. And many of these events will modify what you get there, the cost you play, or allow you to take actions more than once. There's a wide variety of different events.
While you are taking these actions, you will also be managing your colonists. Whenever you can get new colonists, they can be placed into any of your existing buildings that have room for them. Any leftovers go into the shelter on your player board. Whenever you build a building, you can immediately move colonists from your shelter into it, but you can't take colonists from another building.
Now, after all 7 regions of the board are resolved, you move to an upkeep phase. Players can swap one of their colonists and then activate each of their fully staffed buildings in any order they choose. Next, you have to pay 1 energy per colonist in the outpost and lose any colonists you can't afford. Then the board is reseeded as we just described, including drawing a new event. A new first player is determined, starting with the player to the left of where I was the snow cat, and doing the whole, if you don't want to put resource on it and pass it around.
At the end of 6 rounds, players calculate their score. While playing, points are awarded through some of the underwater buildings, many of the expeditions, by putting low dice at the outpost, and through some events. At the end of the game, players will earn additional points for leftover resources, each of their fully staffed above-ground buildings, total number of buildings, sets of colonists, the number of medals they have collected, and their remaining briefcases. Player with the most point wins.
While that covers everything mechanically at a high level, what it doesn't really get across is how the game plays at the table. Each round of the Artemis Project is filled with difficult decisions. This is one of those games where there are lots of things you want to do and no way at all to do them all. The first 3 rounds of the game are all about engine building, starting with making sure you have enough resources to actually start building some buildings, and you're getting the colonists you need to fill those buildings so you can activate them. You also want to make sure, though, that you're taking part in at least a few expeditions, both due to the fact they have some really good rewards, but also you're going to lose points at the end of the game if you haven't collected a few medals.
Not a single round goes by where you didn't wish you had more dice and different values on the dice you do have. I would say that this struggle is actually rather thematic, reflecting the struggles of trying to survive on a hostile world.
Now, interestingly, about halfway through the game, the focus of the game shifts. The resource generation and extra action buildings stop coming out. They may still be up for a couple turns if no one buys them, but the whole game starts to become about end game scoring. Competition for buildings and colonists becomes more fierce, and people try to up their medal count. Things that seemed easy, like fully staffing buildings, becomes harder because you only swap one a turn. Some players were also going to start amassing things, gathering lots of energy or materials or medals or briefcases for endgame scoring based on which buildings they purchase.
Here, your choices in the early game can either help you surge ahead or come back to bite you. There's a lot of randomness in this game, and it will impact you. So all your planning and careful choices may be ruined by the buildings you want not coming up or an event crushing your expectations.
Yeah, it does feel like those events are extra punishing, but you know what? They affect all the players the same, so seems balanced in the end. The Artemis Project, to me, features one of the best dice-based worker placement systems I've ever played with. And a big part of this is how the different regions of the board have their own placement rules. Once you start playing this game, you quickly realize how important it is to look around, to look at what dice the other players have available. You can't just play this one as multiplayer solitaire. You've got to watch for where you can be outbid or bumped and where you may be able to do the same to others. Like, do you place a 6 in the vents because you really need 6 energy? Well, if everyone else has a bunch of low dice, you're going to run the risk of exposure. Maybe you'd be better playing a 4. Or you know what? Maybe use 2 threes to get those resources just to make sure you get in there on the ground floor. Can you get away with putting a 1 die on that building? If you get away with it, you only pay 1 material. But based on the colonists everyone else has, you might look around and go, oh, you know what? It needs scientists. It's not likely someone will get it. But you know what? Those 2 players have 2s, and that's pretty cheap for them if they want to kind of snipe you there. Have 1 die in an expedition? Do you sit and let the round go around and around the table? And is someone going to join you? Are we going to complete this? Maybe you're better to put a 2nd die there and make sure it gets done. Those are all the kind of decisions you're going to have to make.
You're on a planet with scarcity, fighting for resources and survival. This isn't a happy, friendly co-op. You won't win without acting selfishly and focusing on your needs. Even if you choose not to act maliciously, this, of course, may mean the game isn't for all groups.
Yeah, with all the bumping and outbidding, the Artemis Project can be very cutthroat and quite nasty, and that's going to turn off some players. Unlike many worker placement games, there is a ton of player interaction here. Pretty much every die placed is going to affect not only you, but at least one of your other opponents, if not all of them. And it's not uncommon that your well-laid plans are cut off by someone else's play. Sometimes intentionally, but often unintentionally.
There's really only one place on the entire board that doesn't impact other players, and that's usually a last resort if everything else has failed.
Now, one thing I do like is while there are seven different places you can place your die, and the initial teach of this game, there's a lot to download, but each individual region resolves in a way that's easy to learn, and they resolve quickly. Plus, there's that thematic tie-in. We've already brought it up in this review, but we've mentioned in a number of our recent reviews, the games that are tied close to their theme are easier to remember and easier to teach. Here, expeditions represent taking a risk to get a reward, just like exploring a moon's surface would. Whoever gets to the mines and vents first gets resources, and those trying to take too much might miss out. Right after mining those materials, you're probably going to be spending them on buildings. It's literally the next step in the game. How much you have to pay for a building is going to be based on market demand. If you really want a building, go for it. Bid high for it. Make sure you get it. Or try to take a chance bidding low, hoping no one undercuts you, or I guess overcuts you. Getting the doorstep early means you're going to get your pick of the crowd of the new colonists coming off of the shake ship. The mechanics just make sense when looked at through the lens of the theme of building a space colony.
The only mechanic I would say that doesn't feel as thematic compared to the rest of the game is the exposure. The amount of benefit you get from losing out, while certainly a valid game mechanic, doesn't feel as much like a valid thematic one. Of course, if you didn't see some benefit here, the game would be downright cruel.
Yeah, true. Yeah, I think this was a mechanical addition. It's explained thematically that when you're affected by exposure, that you get relief from Earth. I don't know if that's supposed to be them feeling bad for you, or I don't know, someone launched a GoFundMe after your people had a bad experience and got left out in the snow. I don't know what it actually ties into.
Crowdfunding space projects. There we go.
Exactly. To tie it into the rest of this episode. Now, the other thing with this game, and we've kind of already mentioned this in a way, is that this is a game that rewards repeated plays. Knowing what expedition cards there are, what buildings could potentially come up, and what events could come up in the deck are going to give experienced players an advantage. And they're going to help players who know the game with overall strategic planning. When playing at the full player count, you're going to see every expedition card. Every single one comes up into play. And due to the fact there are two copies of every building, with the highest player count, there's a really good chance you're going to see at least one copy of each building, if not all of them. Now, this is, of course, different at lower player counts where you don't know for sure what will come up. So the lower the player count, actually, the more randomness in the game.
As well, knowing the value of resources and their importance at various points in the game, as well as experience with the many various endgame scoring options and which are likely to be most important, you're likely going to play the game very differently the more you know about the game. Mm-hmm. And new players can actually throw a wrench into things by skewing expectations of how you might think other players ought to behave, which can also impact your strategy.
Yeah, very true. So overall, the Artemis Project is a very solid dice-driven worker placement engine builder that I personally really enjoy. Like, just dice-driven worker placement engine builder gets me excited. Those are some of my favorite types of games. I love engine building games. I like engine worker placement games. Dice-driven, it's handled really well in this game. Artemis Project, to me, does enough new things and differently from other games that it sticks out in my growing collection of engine builders. I've got a lot of them. This one still stands out as unique, different, and fun in its own way. Now, one of the highlights for me, though, that really makes this step up a level is the amount of punch it packs in only 6 rounds and under 2 hours of playtime. You get a group of experienced players, we're talking an hour and a half playtime. Every time I finished a game of Artemis Project, I felt like I've accomplished something. I built an engine. Look at what I built, right? Look at my colony. It's just that limited options, the limited resources really gives you a feeling of accomplishment when you finish. There's just something rewarding about the play experience here.
I think this game for me is right on the edge of being too harshly competitive, but it saves itself because of that reasonably quick playing time. If this game had another couple of rounds, I think it would likely be too much take that and hate drafting for me. But in its existing state, it manages to sort of sit right in that comfort zone.
Yeah, where for me, this game is a perfect fit. Like, it's also my Euro-loving wife digs this game as well. But I do know it's not going to be for everyone. The biggest thing to watch for, though, is that take that screw your opponent nature of the game. Resources are limited. You are going to be competing for them. Plus, there are a couple buildings that are directly confrontational. They target the other players in a rather mean way. Note, if you do want to remove a bit of the in-your-face conflict, take those buildings out. But even without them, you're still going to get cut off. You're going to get bumped. You're going to get outbid. You're going to make a plan with another player to oust someone out of somewhere. This game can get nasty.
If you're dead set against Take That and highly competitive games where players can impact your play, this might not be for you. But if a little of that works for you, I would say this is worth a try because of the tight gameplay and reasonable game length.
Now, you can pick up a copy of the Artemis Project direct from Grand Gamers Guild at grandgamersguild.com. Be sure to save 10% off by using our coupon code Bellhop. That's B-E-L-L-H-O-P. Now, we did mention at the start of this review, there are three different versions of the game. And while I think the retail version is a good option, especially if it means supporting your friendly local game store, I think the Pioneer Edition is the sweet spot here. It's only $10 more than the retail price, the MSRP on the retail, and you get some great component improvements as well as a mini expansion, which is pretty neat. While the medal badges included in the Galileo edition are nice, like really nice, like they're some of the most fun to hold board game components I've had, they don't actually add anything to the game. They're just a nice to have to me.
Well, that's it for our look at the Artemis Project, a very solid dice-driven worker placement game about colonizing Europa. There are now quite a few dice-driven worker placement games out there. What's your favorite? Are you still playing Alien Frontiers? Did Stonemaier win you over with Euphoria, Build a Better Dystopia? Or have you discovered something else? We'd love to hear about it in the comments.
Or you can join us on the Tabletop Bellhop Discord at discord.tabletopbellhop.com and tell us all about it.